वेलकम बैक फ्रेंड्स. नाउ इन दिस वीडियो वी गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट सर्टेन फैक्टर्स दैट आर इम्पॉर्टेंट प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ बैक्टीरिया दैट दे आर हैविंग टू इवेड आवर होस्ट इम्यूनिटी बिकॉज द होस्ट इम्यून सिस्टम इज ऑलवेज ट्राइंग टू प्रोटेक्ट अस अगेंस्ट दोज हार्मफुल पैथोजेंस एंड देर आर सर्टेन वेज प्रोड्यूस्ड बाई पैथोजेंस टू इवेड आवर होस्ट इम्यून सिस्टम and to elude the system, and there are many many different types of processes of that. Now in this video I am going to talk about five major type of strategies taken up by pathogens to elude our immune system. One is the antigenic distinguishes. Antigenic distinguishes is a process for the antigens to hide inside some self molecules. So let's say antigen can only be detected by our immune system if it is free. If our immune system cells can take this up and recognize it as non-self, then only it can take some action against it. But what happens in this case, some antigen molecules try to force themselves inside self molecules, inside some cell materials. As they are hiding itself inside the self molecules, then those self molecules cannot be recognizable by our self cells. So as a result of that, cell remains healthy. And those pathogen remains healthy actually. Our cell cannot recognize those pathogen as antigen because they are hiding themselves inside our self cell components. Second thing is the immunosuppression. Now immunosuppression is again another thing. For example, normally what happens usually that they can suppress the activity of the immune cells specifically. And how? That normally what we know that if the cell is present there, if the cell is there for, let's say, place for a longer period of time throughout the bloodstream, then our immune system cells can recognize it, can catch it, kill it, and everything can be done. But if that pathogen is residing and hiding somewhere else for very longer period of time, it just stays there for a longer period of time and then start to grow and start infecting again, it can go against the infectivity property or it can go against the immunity property. For example, Salmonella typhi is a bacteria causing the typhoid fever. Now what happens in that case, Salmonella typhi usually first when it introduces and it reaches the bloodstream, it start to provide or start acting like antigen. So what it does, if it start and continuously behaving like antigen, it will soon generate many more immune response, but it won't allow this to happen. What it does, it actually residing inside our gallbladder for 7 to 8 hours, and during that time all of our immune system think that everything is going fine, no antigen is there in the blood, and then they just go away. Once they leave the street, once they leave the bloodstream, in that case again the Salmonella typhi thrives again into the bloodstream and start dividing and infecting other regions and start multiplying there. So that is the strategy of immunosuppression. So they try to find the situation when the immune system is compromised, when the immune system is a little bit suppressed, and then they start thriving the infection, start spreading the infection. The third thing is a specific immune response, though it's not that much correct. Again, it is again disguising and staying somewhere where the cop cannot find, because there are cells, cop cells in our immune system. These are called macrophages, killer cells, and all the cytotoxic killer cells, and all of them. Now they are acting as cop, and these are the bad people. Now what they are doing in this case, they are hiding in those cells and regions where usually cop won't raid. So normally what happens inside our body, there are certain regions or certain sections normally where the immune system cells are patrolling all the time usually, and there are other regions which is free from all those immune system cells many times. So because not all of our tissue and all of our cells are protected very at the same amount by our immune cells, because there are certain regions which are not that much taken care of by the immune cells, and the bacteria or pathogen, other pathogens, target those regions to stay for a longer period of time persistently and then start to form the infection. Now the fourth thing is the induction of ineffective antibody. Now what happens, let's say a bacteria is there, bacteria can itself act as antigen, it can secrete some molecule, that molecule can act as antigen. Now whatever it is, the antigen is in the surface of the bacteria. Now that antigen bacteria know which is the important antigenic part, so it itself produces certain molecules which are immunogenic, but it is not that much harmful for the host cell. So it starts to produce those materials which are non-harmful for the host but can generate immune response. Right? So they start to produce those molecules. So what happens in this case, in this induction process, if this is the antigen, say let's say these red things are those antigens which are very deadly and dangerous, but these green things are not that much dangerous, but they start producing all of them. But this green can also produce antibody against this particular antigen. So it will trigger the production of antibodies. A lot of antibody will come and bind with this green section. So as they are more in nature, as they are more, so you can see this green, though they are not harmful, though they are not necessary for causing the infection, but still the pathogen is providing them, they are producing them because they try to make a immune response against this antigen inside the host body. Now if you look at here, let's say these green molecules are 50 and this red are only 3, but these 3 are dangerous. This green or not, but as the green molecules are present in higher amounts, they will generate the immune response much more faster. So as they generate the response faster, they will produce more and more antibody against these green antigens, which are not at all that much important at this time, because we know to protect the host cell, it needs to produce the antibody against this red one, because as in very less amount, this host cell think that this is not that important, let's first put the antibody against a high percentage of antigen. So they are producing that and they are protecting these antigens, but on the other hand, these antigens start to act deadly and they start to make the responses inside the body. They are damaging our host cells, host tissues in our body. That's the thing that always occurs here using this. So this type of antibody is generated against the this green kind of, or this non-harmful kind of antigens are called induction of ineffective antibody. So these antibodies are called ineffective antibodies because that these antibodies are not that much required here. And the final thing is the antigenic variation or antigenic phase change or shift. Now what does it mean? That normally, if the example is Neisseria gonorrhoeae, in case of Neisseria gonorrhoeae infection or gonococci infection, what we see, then in those case, if we look at the genome, for the pili, which is required for the addition to the host cells, the pili protein. Now pili, the protein name is pili, not pili, which is coming out from the surface of the cell. This is the protein which is termed as pili. Okay, now we are having this pili protein. Now the pili protein is responsible for causing a very aggressive infection. Now what happens if the host cell previously encountered with this Neisseria gonorrhoeae and this same type of pili, it might have antibody raised against it. So what it will do now, when for the second time the Neisseria is infecting that host, it is varying this pili gene. For example, what happens here, if this is a gene and there are sections of many combinations of pili can be possible. Let's say, for example, let's say here in this case 4. Actually, there are six different genes that are present. Now, the different combinations of those genes can give rise to many variety of pili proteins. So, as they can change the variety of pili protein, each time it is infecting an individual, it is very, very difficult for the memory cells to cope up with this situation also. Right? So, that's why this kind of situation can be deadly for host cells. So there are many more, but these are the major things that we know. Now we find that they are eluding, they are escaping first of all, they are hiding, and they are changing and fooling our immune system in these different ways. But in either ways, these are the systems that are required as the evading. Remember, we have talked about each of these factors, additions, invasions, spreading factors. Now we are talking about this invading the host defense. We have left with these toxins, we'll be dealing with the toxins in the next video. But that's how they successfully create an infection, and creating the infection is not enough. Spreading the infection is not enough until and unless you go against the host defense, because if you try to spread an infection, our host defense is try to block you, and if the host defense blocks you, then you are no longer be able to cause the infection. So to cause the infection, you need to go against or elude our immune defense or host defenses. Then you can set a perfect infection. That's how the whole thing is actually established, and I hope that's helpful. Thank you.